The purpose of using classical approximate methods, that is either a variational method or weighted residual method, is to convert these differential equations into set of linear algebraic equation. Now from this differential equation, we expect the value of u. We expect the value of u, and that is what exactly we get. That is what exactly we get after converting them into the set of linear algebraic equation. For example, here this value of a1 will be, the value of a1 will be p by ae, and if I substitute this back here in this expression, I get u as p by ae times x. But variational method doesn't directly convert these differential equations into the set of linear algebraic equation. It does this in one extra step, and that step is nothing but converting or expressing this differential equation, converting or expressing this differential equation in an equivalent integral form, in an equivalent integral form. For example, for this differential equation, this differential equation can be converted into the equivalent integral form as I equal to ae by 2 du by dx square minus qu dx over some domain. Here the domain is from 0 to L. Now, while studying this variational method, what we will be learning is how to convert this differential equation in this equivalent integral form, and from here how to convert this equivalent integral form into the set of linear algebraic equation. So this is what we'll be studying in variational method. The variational method gives us the set of linear algebraic equation from the given differential equation by converting first the differential equation into equivalent integral form. And this is where we come across a term called as functional. This integral, this equivalent integral which we have obtained, are also called as functional. Now, what are functional? Functionals are nothing but it is a function of some other function. What do we exactly mean by this? Suppose we have y is equal to x square. Here the y is a function of x, and suppose say if we have z as sine of y, then z here is a function of y. In other words, z can be called as functional, because it is a function of some other function. In this case, this will be called as functional. Here this I is a function of u, and this u is further a function of x, and that is why this will be called as a functional. Now this integral will be further converted, or we will try to reduce this in this form, that is linear algebraic form. And how this is done is, we will make this integral to reach its extremum value. So extremum can be either its minimum or maximum value, and that is how we will finally end up getting a set of linear algebraic equation from this given differential equation. So again, a variational method converts the given differential equation first to a equivalent integral form, and then it converts this equivalent integral form to the set of linear algebraic equation. Let us consider this diagram here. Now this is the diagram of say x, or this is the graph of say x versus u. And let this point be x1 and x2, and this point be u1 and u2. This is nothing but, this graph which you can see is nothing but, let us assume that this is the exact solution of a given differential equation. This is the exact solution of a given differential equation. We know that the solution to the differential equation is always in terms of some function, and let that be the this function, which is nothing but the exact solution to the given differential equation. Now in case of variational method or any classical approximate methods, what we do is first we assume it, this is the exact solution. But in case of any approximate method, first we assume a trial function, some trial function, and we proceed from there on. And then we proceed from there on. First we will assume a trial function. Now this difference between the exact solution and our trial function can be called as some change or a variation. This change is, this difference can be termed as some change or variation. Now the variational calculus is nothing but trying out this different trial function and minimizing this variation. So this is nothing but a variational calculus. Variational calculus is nothing but, it is a mathematical concept of trying out these various trial functions and minimizing the variation to match our trial function with the exact solution. The way we had here the equivalent integral of this given differential equation, a general form of integral can be written as a is equal to some function of x, u, its first derivative, its second derivative, and so on. So this is nothing but, this is the equivalent integral form or a functional. Here the a is a functional because a is a function of u, and further u is a function of x. Also here a is a function of u dash, and u dash is a function of x. That is why this term is called as functional. And of course we can put here some domain, or we can specify that domain as x1 to x2. So this is a functional. And while assuming, once we have been able to obtain a functional from given differential equation, the next step in the variational method is to assume a trial function. Now while assuming a trial function, we will make sure that this trial function satisfies the boundary condition. This is the most important thing. If you look here carefully, these are exactly matching at the boundaries. What are the boundaries? Here the boundary conditions are, at x equal to x1, we have u as u1, and at x equal to x2, we have u as u2. These are boundary conditions, and while assuming the trial function, we make sure that our trial function satisfies the boundary condition. Right, so this is all about the variational calculus or the variational method. Again, just to summarize, in variational approach, a series of tentative or trial solutions will be considered, which will not match with that of the exact solution. There will be some variation, and the process of minimizing this variation is called as variational calculus. The process of trying out the series of trial function and minimizing the variation is called as the variational calculus or the variational method. Now let us exactly see how this variational calculus method works. We'll assume a trial function. First, we'll assume a trial function, and for assuming a trial function, I will use a quadratic polynomial. Here, assuming a trial function is totally up to us. In this case, I have assumed, let us assume a quadratic trial function. Assuming a trial function is totally up to us. We can go for a quadratic trial function or a quadratic polynomial function. We have assumed a quadratic polynomial function, or trial function can be a quadratic polynomial function or a linear function or a cubic polynomial function and so on. Also, we can assume a trigonometric function. Also, we can assume any trigonometric function in terms of sine or in terms of cos and so on. It is totally up to us. Fine. So let us, in order to understand how this variational method works, we'll first assume a quadratic trial function, and then we will perturb this value, or we will disturb this value slightly. We are not changing its nature, but we are slightly disturbing this value, and that I will represent by u of tilde. This symbol can be called as tilde. It is nothing but it is slightly a perturbed value, perturbed, or a disturbed value of the trial function, and that is nothing but it can be given as a naught plus change in a naught. This symbol stands for change in a naught plus a1 change in a1 times x plus a2 change in a2 times x square. Now, the variation or change in trial function or trial solution is given by this symbol and u. This symbol is nothing but the variation in u. This is equal to perturbed value minus the actual assumed value, and this should give us a naught plus delta a naught minus a naught will give us delta a naught plus a1 plus delta a1 minus a1 will give us delta a1 times x, and similarly delta a2 times x square. So this is nothing but a variation in our trial function or a trial solution. Similarly, by similar analysis, we can also find that change in derivative of u will be derivative of this, that is nothing but delta a1 plus 2 times delta a2 x. We'll be looking at these properties. The derivative and variation or the change are interchangeable. You can first take a derivative and then take a variation, or first take a variation and then take a derivative. They are interchangeable. We'll be looking at these properties later on. But the way we have found here, the change in the function is delta a naught plus delta a1 x plus delta a2 x square. Similarly, the change in the derivative of u will be delta a1 plus 2 times delta a2 x. And similarly, change in, suppose say we have u square, and that can be written as change in the u function minus the original u function. So these are some of the properties in case of variational calculus, and more of it we'll be looking at more of these properties later on. But For here, what you need to understand is that the change in u or the variation in u can be given as change in a naught, change in a naught plus change in a1 plus change in a2, and with the coefficient here as 1, coefficient here as x, and coefficient here as x square. This is what we need to take from this explanation, and then what we can do is we'll take a partial derivative of our expression u of x with respect to a0, a1 and a2. So we have here u as a0 plus a1x plus a2x square. So derivative of u with respect to a0, partial derivative of u with respect to a0 will give us 1, right? If we take the partial derivative of this u with respect to a0, that will give us 1. Similarly, with respect to a1 will give us x, and with respect to a2 will give us x square, right? So partial derivative of u with respect to a0 gives us 1, with respect to a1 gives us x, and partial derivative of u with respect to a2 gives us x square. Now these values are nothing but the coefficients of variation of u, right? These are nothing but the coefficients here in the variation of u. So if I substitute this values in place of this coefficient, what we get is del u, or change in u, delta u, or the change in u is nothing but partial derivative of u with respect to a naught multiplied by change in a naught plus partial derivative of u with respect to a1 times change in a1 plus partial derivative of u with respect to a2 times change in a2. And this is a very important expression in case of variational method. This is the very important expression. Now what this tells us is that this expression relates the variation in u, this is nothing but the variation in u is related to its total differentiation, right? This is the total differentiation of u. So variation in u can be related to its total differentiation or total differential. This expression relates variation in u to its total differential, and this is a very important expression. Now if you look at this expression carefully, we had assumed a trial function up to a2, and that is why we got this expression, and that is how we got this expression. Now if suppose say we had a trial function such as u is equal to a0 plus a1x up to an x raised to n, in that case this expression would have been variation in u as partial derivative of u with respect to a0 times change in a0 plus variation in u plus partial derivative of u with respect to a1, variation of a1 time and up to a raised to n, up to the partial derivative of u with respect to a n times the change in a n. So this is the expression which relates the variation in u in terms of its total differential. Now if you look here carefully, this change in a naught, are the perturbed parameters. These are the perturbed parameters, and these values cannot be equal to zero. Change in a naught, change in a1 up to change in an are they are perturbed values and they cannot be equal to zero. But our aim is to reduce this variation. Our aim is to reduce this variation. This variation is nothing but change in view, and our aim is to make this variation zero, right? For this assumed trial solution or the assumed trial function, in order to match this assumed trial function with the exact solution, our aim will be to make this variation zero. And in that case, we have also seen now that our aim is to make this term zero, right? But we have seen that these terms cannot be zero. This term is not equal to zero. This term is not equal to zero, right? This term is not equal to zero. And therefore, the only way to make this variation zero is by making this term zero. This term's zero. And this is something, a big statement that we'll be writing now, that since our aim is to make variation in U equal to zero, but since change in A0, change in A1 up to change in AN cannot be equal to zero. Therefore, partial derivative of U with respect to A1 up to partial derivative of U with respect to AN must be equal to zero individually. Fine, this term has to be zero, and this term has to be zero. This is a very important statement, and based on this we'll be using this variational method in order to obtain the solution of the given differential equation. To sum up, what we have seen is In case of variational method, we convert first the given differential equation of a problem into its equivalent integral form, and further at this step, what we'll do is we'll assume a trial function. Here we'll assume a trial function, and by assuming a trial function at this stage, we'll convert this equivalent integral form into a set of linear algebraic equation. Now, while assuming a trial function, our aim will be that this assumed trial function matches exactly with the exact solution. Fine, and in that case, this we end up getting something called as variation, and our aim is to equate this variation to zero, and this can be done from this expression. That is, we have obtained the expression of change in U or variation in U in terms of total differential, and our aim is to make this term as zero, and that can be done only by equating this each partial derivative terms equal to zero, because we have seen that these are the perturbed values and this cannot be equal to zero. Right? That is why the only way to make this zero is by equating individually the partial derivatives of U with respect to its each parameter and equating them to zero. So this value will be zero, this value will be zero, this value will be zero, and finally we'll get the change in U as zero. And once we get the change in U as zero, then our assumed function or the assumed trial function will be approximately equal to the exact solution. But here the most important condition is, while assuming a trial function, we need to make sure that they satisfy the given boundary conditions. This is the most important thing. Trial function should satisfy given boundary condition. this trial function should satisfy a given boundary condition. Fine. We'll look more into this once we start solving some problems. But before that, these are few identities in variational calculus. These are few identities in variational calculus. The variation of u raised to n is n u raised to n minus 1 times change in u. Almost similar to the derivative identity which we have seen in the derivatives, right? Variation of u plus v will be variation of u plus variation of v. Variation of x times u is x times variation of u, because this variation is only related to u and not to x, and that is why x can be taken out. This is again a very important identity, that is differentiation or integration and variation can be interchanged. That is, derivative of variation of u can be written as variation of derivative of u. That is, variation, we are taking it out, and first we take first variation or we take first derivative and then take variation, we will get the same result. Similarly, it applies to integration. Whether we first take a variation and then integrate, or first take a integration and then take a variation, it will give us same result. Fine. Then some function times variation in u can be written as variation of that function times u, where f is some function of x. And then this is again an important identity. This is the application of this. See, the variation of u square from this identity will give us two times u, right? Two times u and variation of u, and multiplied by this half will give us u derivative of u into variation of u, and again extend it to its derivative. This is the case, and if I can use this identity here, that is variation of integral is nothing but we can use this identity, and I can take this variation inside. So all these identities are useful if we try to solve a given differential equation with long end approach. We'll solve one problem with long end approach, but just for the sake of demonstration we will look at this, and then finally we will derive something called as Euler-Lagrange equation, and we will see that this long end approach can be tackled more effectively by using something called as Euler-Lagrange equation. But just for the sake of demonstration, we will see one problem with long end approach, and then after deriving the Euler-Lagrange equation, we will try to solve the same problem with the help of this, and we will see how we can reduce some steps and we can achieve our target, that is of obtaining the linear equations from a given differential equation.